This is Abdul from Pythonist. I hope you're doing well. Awareness and the understanding of useful functions available in any programming language is very helpful. So in this video, I'm going to expose some very useful built-in functions available in Python 3. So let's get started. The very first function is the map function. The map function applies a given function to each item of an iterable, which can be list or tuples, and returns a list of the results. The syntax of the map function is simply map. Then inside this function, we can pass two different parameters. The first parameter is the function which we want to apply for each item of that particular iterable. And the second parameter, of course, we have to pass the iterable on which we have to apply that particular function. The map function returns a list of the results. So let's try to write a very simple example to understand how this map function works. So very first, I will define a simple function called square to just take the square of any number, and inside this function I will return the square. Then I will define a tuple of numbers with elements 1 to 4. Then we will just create a variable called result, and I will call the map function. And inside this map function, I will pass the function which I want to apply, which is square. And then the second thing we have to pass is the iterable, which is tuple in our case called numbers. So I will pass that particular tuples and print the result. You can see that actually inside the result we have the square of all of these numbers. So that's how the map function works. Each item of the tuple is squared, since map function expects a function to be passed in. But lambda functions are commonly used while working with map functions. The next function is the zip function. The zip function takes iterables and makes iterator that aggregates elements based on the iterables passed and returns an iterator of tuples. The syntax of zip function is simply zip. Inside that we have to pass all of the iterables. And the zip function which takes the iterable parameters can be built-in iterables like string or dict. And we can also pass the user-defined iterables, like we can pass our own object which has gender iter method. The zip function returns an iterator of tuples based on the iterable object. If no parameters are passed, zip returns an empty iterator. If a single iterable is passed, zip returns an iterator of 1 tuples, meaning the number of elements in each tuple is 1. Let's write a very simple example to understand this function. So I will define two different lists. One is the numbers with elements 1, 2, and 3, and the second one named as strings with the elements as 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so let me first try the zip function without any iterables. So I will create a variable result and call the zip function against it. Then we will convert that result into list and print that out. You can see the result here as an empty list. Okay, so now let's try to pass two iterables which we have created, numbers and strings, into this zip function. Once again, I will create a result variable and call the zip function with two iterables, and we will convert it to set and print that out. You can see the result here with the tuples, and this set has three tuples, 2, 3, and 1, and each tuple has two elements from both of these two iterables. That's how a zip function combines multiple iterables at one place in the form of tuples. That's great. The next function is the super function. The super built-in returns a proxy object that allows you to refer parent class by super. In Python, super built-in has two major use cases. Number one, it allows us to avoid using base class explicitly. And the second one is working with multiple inheritance can be easier by using this super keyword. Okay, let's try to write a very simple example for using this super function with a single inheritance in mind. In case of single inheritance, it allows us to refer base class by super method. So let's try to write a very simple example. So I will define a class called memo which takes an object. Then inside this class, I will create a gender init method which takes the self and the mammal name parameter. Then I will simply print the mammal name variable inside gender init method. Now I will define another class called dog, which will inherit the memo class. So we will simply pass the memo inside this dot class. Then once again inside this class, I will define gender init method, which takes only the self. Then I will simply print a simple statement, and below that, I will call the super method dot gender init and pass this dog. If we create the instance of the dog class and run the program, you will see that here two statements has been printed. The first one is dog has four legs, and the second statement is dog. You can notice that here we are calling the super method instead of directly calling the mammal class. That's a very simple introduction to this super method. The next function we are going to explore here is called hash function. The hash method returns the hash value of an object if it has one. Hash values are just integers which are used to compare dictionary keys during a dictionary lookup quickly. Internally, hash method calls the gender hash method of an object which are set by default for any object. The syntax of the hash function is simply hash, then we have to pass the object to that particular method. And that's the only parameter hash function will take. The hash method returns the hash value of an object and it has 1. If an object has custom gender hash method, it truncates the return value to the size of pi s size underscore t. Okay, let's try to understand how the hash function works for different data types. So first I will write a print statement and call the hash function for an integer, let's say 190. The second print statement, let's try a decimal value, for example 171.23, and print that out. And the third value I want to try here the hash method for is a string. So let's try to pass a string, let's say Python, and run the program. You can see here actually the different hash values, but for the integer it is the same. The integer value is not going to be changed by calling the hash method, but the decimal and the string value has been converted to the numerical values. But keep in mind that the hash method only works for immutable objects as tuple. So if we create a tuples called vowels and print the hash for that particular tuple by passing it to the hash function and run the program, you can see the result here. That's how the hash function works for different data types. Our next method is the format. The built-in format method returns a formatted representation of the given value controlled by the format specifier. The format method is similar to string format method. Internally, both methods call gender format method of an object. While built-in format method is a low-level implementation for formatting an object using gender format internally. String format is a higher level implementation able to perform complex formatting operations on multiple object string as well. The syntax of the format method is simply format, then we have to pass the value, then we have to define the format specification. So it means the format method takes two parameters, the value that needs to be formatted, and the format spec, the specification on how the value should be formatted. The format method returns a formatted representation of a given value specified by the format specifier. Let's try to write a very simple example. Okay, let's try to call this format method for an integer. So I will call print, then call the format method and pass an integer value as 1 to 3. And then we have to specify our format specification. Let me pass the d because this is an integer value. For the second statement, I will pass a float value and pass the f as the format spec. And for the third statement, I will once again pass an integer value and pass the b for the binary format. So if you run this program, you can see here we have the very first statement, it's printed straightforward, and the second statement has been just formatted as float. And the third statement has been formatted as the binary representation of number 12. That's how the format function works. Our next method is enumerate. The enumerate method adds counter to an iterables and returns it. Its syntax is simply the enumerate, then we have to pass the iterables and a start. The iterable, it can be a sequence, an iterator, or objects that supports iteration. And the start parameter is an optional parameter. If you pass it, it starts counting from this number. If start is omitted, 0 is taken as start. Okay, let's try to write a very simple example to understand how this method works. So I will define a list of grocery with different elements like bread, milk, and butter. Then we will apply the enumerate method onto this list. Then I will print three different statements. The first statement is simply the type of this enumerate. The second statement simply converting this enumerate variable to the list and print that out. And for the third one, let's change the default counter and start it with 10 and print that out. You can see the result of all of these three print statements here. The first statement simply prints its type as class enumerate. The second one prints a list of tuples where each element has been printed with its index. And you can see that index is starting from 0 because we haven't passed any start parameter. But for the third statement, you see that it prints out all of these elements with a different index which starts from 10 because we passed this start parameter while calling the enumerate method for that particular list. That's how the enumerate function works. Our next method is MemoryView. The MemoryView method returns a MemoryView object of the given argument. But before getting into this method, we have to understand the buffer protocol. Simply said, buffer protocol provides a way to access the internal data of an object. This internal data is a memory array or a buffer. This protocol is only accessible to use at the C API level and not using our normal code base. So in order to expose the same protocol to normal Python code base, MemoryView method is here. MemoryView is a safe way to expose the buffer protocol in Python. It allows you to access the internal buffer of an object by creating a MemoryView object. Its syntax is very simple. We have to call the MemoryView method and pass our object. But keep in mind that this object must support buffer protocol, like bytes or byte array. Let's write a very simple example to understand the MemoryView method. So I will define a very simple byte array, it's named as byte array, and pass a very simple string and its format as UTF-8. Then I will call the MemoryView method and pass this byte array to the MemoryView function. Then let's print out its 0th index and 0:2 to create byte from MemoryView, and the third print statement will be to create list from the MemoryView. If we run this program, you can see the result of all of these three print statements. The very first statement simply prints the number 65 because this is the binary representation of letter A. The second statement prints the byte array of AB, the first two elements. Finally, we accessed all indices of MV and converted it to a list. Since internally byte array stores ASCII value for the alphabet, the output is a list of ASCII values of A, B, and C. That's how the MemoryView function works. Our next method is pow. The pow method returns x to the power of y. If the third argument z is given, it returns x to the power of y modulus z. So it means that this method takes three parameters. The first one is x, which is the number which is to be powered. The second parameter is y, number which is to be powered with x. And the third parameter is z, which is optional. And it is number which is to be used for modulus operation. So if we simply print a statement pow into 2:2, it will simply print the 4 because 2^2 is 4. You can try this function with different values for x and y and see the result here. Our next method is repr. The repr method returns a printable representation of the given object. It takes only a single parameter, which is an object. Object whose printable representation has to be returned. So let's create a very simple variable called var equal to foo. And if we call the repr method for this variable, you can see the result here. The repr method returns foo inside double quotes. It is important to that foo is a string, so it's represented by the single quote. Foo without the quotes would assign var to foo variable. This is important because the repr returns a string that would be of the same value as passed to the eval function. Our next method is strip. If the string has white spaces at the beginning or at the end, it removes them. So for example, if we create a variable a and just passed and assigned it a string with the space at the beginning and at the end, If we call the strip method for this string variable and print the result, you will see that it prints the string without these spaces. Okay, the next method is round. The round method returns the floating point number rounded off to the given n digits after the decimal point. If no n digits is provided, it rounds off the number to the nearest integer. The round method takes two different parameters. The first one is number. A number that is to be rounded. The second parameter is n digits, a number up to which the given number is to be rounded. If the n digits not provided, nearest integer to the given number. If two multiples are really close, rounding is done toward the even choice. If n digits parameter is given, then floating point number rounded off to the n digits, always rounded to the closest multiple of 10 to the power minus n digits. So let's try a very simple example to understand this round method. So if I call the round method for integer 10, it simply prints out that same integer. Because it's an integer value, so there's no point for round. But if we call the round method for a floating point, for example 10.7, it will print the number 11. Because 7 is much closer to the 10. And the same thing if we call the round method for 5.5, it will print the number 6. But if we round a number to given n digit places, we have to pass this. So if we call the round method by passing a floating point as 2.6, 6 and 5 and pass the 2 as n digits, it will print the number 2.67. That's how the round method works. The next one is the EBS method. The EBS method returns the absolute value of the given number. If the number is a complex number, the EBS method returns its magnitude. It takes only one parameter, which is actually a num. A num whose absolute value is to be returned. The number can be an integer, floating number, or a complex number. For integer, this value returns the absolute value. For floating numbers, the floating absolute value is returned. And for a complex number, the magnitude of the number is returned. Let's try to write a very simple example to understand this method. So I will create an integer with value minus 20 and call the EBS method for this integer and print that out. And the second one, I will create a floating variable with the value minus 30.33. And once again, call the EBS method for this floating value and print the result. You can see the result here. For minus 20, it prints its absolute value, which is 20, an integer. And for the floating value, it prints out the 30.33, which is the floating absolute value for that particular floating variable. That's how the EBS method works. The next method is DIR. The DIR method tries to return a list of valid attributes of the object. It takes only one parameter, which is an optional. So DIR attempts to return all attributes of this object parameter. So if we call this method for a list, it will print all of the possible methods available for the list. We can also override this method for user-defined objects by defining the dir method. Our next and the last method for this video is clear. It removes all elements of the list. It'll basically delete all of the elements. So if we call that clear for a string, for a list or for a dictionary, it will remove elements from both list and dictionaries. That's it. I tried to share some of the most useful functions available by default in Python 3. I hope you enjoyed this video. So if you like the content, don't forget to give a thumbs up and be sure to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon so you will never miss any fantastic video in the future. Thanks for watching.